Good cinema is always good literature. A well-executed, well-directed piece of cinema is always the distillation of a wide gamut of emotions, crunched into 2-3 hours of on-screen depiction. But the fact remains that any such on-screen rendition of any classic is going to be a second-hand experience. The reason is very simple. What we witness on the screen is the director's take on a material originally conceived by its author. Hence, it is liable to be contaminated with the personal prejudices of a director. Not that it always robs the work of its original beauty. It gives ample scope for a connoisseur worth his salt to understand that both these works are different and independent, and helps him undertake a journey that ends in his broadening his horizons. Now, I do not put much stock in literary reviews or criticism because I feel that they tend to make this already second-hand experience a bit more hands-on. But literary review or criticism is of paramount importance because a dispassionate dissection of a work of art only adds to its beauty and leads to a cultivation of taste. But mine is neither a review or a criticism. This is an attempt to help motivate or inspire a fresh generation of connoisseurs to enjoy the on-screen adaptation, all the while appreciating the beauty of the original work. Hence the name Back to the Bookshelf. Now that the disclaimer is out of the way, let me introduce you to a book that has gone on to inspire, that has gone on to leave a lasting impression on the minds of the generations that have succeeded it. The book is A Tale of Two Cities, written by Charles Dickens. And alongside it is its 21st century modern day adaptation, Dark Knight Rises by Christopher Nolan. Now, in the face of it, one might wonder that this is a comparison between apples and oranges. On the one hand, we have a novel that concerns itself with two cities reeling under the weight of French Revolution, while on the other, we have a movie that revolves around a fictional city and its mythical savior. But there is more to it than meets the eye. However, I am not going to get into the technical side of the novel or the movie, because I feel that any discussion on the technical aspects of a work of art is an exercise in boredom which has the propensity, the power to wean away a prospective reader. So, A Tale of Two Cities revolves around Paris, where the French Revolution breaks out, and London, where the principal characters are based out of. A Tale of Two Cities is a tale of love's triumph over hate. The writer tries to showcase, highlight the exploitation of the poor by the rich elite. It showcases man's capability to undergo immense pain for someone they love and make the supreme sacrifice. But before proceeding any further, it is necessary to draw a brief outline of the French Revolution. The French Revolution began in the year 1789 and spanned for the better part of the 1790s, before culminating in the ascension of Napoleon Bonaparte as the Emperor of France. Now, in the year 1786, King Louis XVI of France realized that his coffers were near empty owing to the protracted involvement in the American Revolution. Even as the people were reeling under the heavy burden of cattle loss, crop loss, and the escalating prices of essential commodities, the monarchy was leading a very extravagant lifestyle. The people were now nursing a resentment against a government that was bleeding them dry with taxes, but not doing enough to bring any respite to the society. It was in this backdrop that around the fag end of 1786, King Louis XVI decided to bring a financial reform package wherein even the elite who were not hitherto taxed were to be taxed. And fearing that there might be an aristocratic rebellion brewing, King Louis XVI decided to convene Estates General. Now, Estates General comprised three estates. The first estate, clergy, The second estate, nobility, and the third estate, the middle class and the poor. So this estates general was to be convened on May 5, 1789. However, there was a simple problem with this convention. The third estate represented around 98% of France's population, but still its suggestions for rational spending on institutional spending could be vetoed by the other two estates because of their noble voting power. Now on June 17, in this backdrop, on June 17, the third estate met and formally adopted the title of National Assembly. On June 20, they met in a nearby indoor tennis court and took the tennis court oath, vowing not to disperse until constitutional reform had been achieved. Now within a week, most of the clerical deputies and 47 liberal nobles began supporting the third estate, leading to Louis XVI on June 27 absorbing all the three orders into the National Assembly. On July 14, rumors began doing rounds that a military coup was impending and a panicked Parisians broke into the Bastille fortress to steal gunpowder and weapons. Now this day, July 14, is commemorated as the day when the French Revolution started. The hysteria led to a popular revolt against an exploitative monarchy. The peasants came onto the streets, looted the tax collectors, the elite, the nobles, to get even with years of exploitation. And this is what is known as the Great Fear. On January 21, 1793, King Louis XVI was condemned to death for high treason and crimes against the state. His head was chopped off in a guillotine. His wife Marie Antoinette suffered the same fate 9 months later. This marked the beginning of Reign of Terror. The French Revolution is the fulcrum around which A Tale of Two Cities revolves. The novel's opening sequence has an aged doctor being released from the Bastille prison after 18 years of incarceration for a crime he scarcely remembers having committed. Now, what was the doctor's crime? It was bearing witness to and daring to testify against two members of a noble family for murdering a peasant boy in cold blood. The peasant boy was trying to seek revenge against the two members of the noble family for raping and murdering his sister. Vengeance forms the backbone of the entire narrative that A Tale of Two Cities is. But then there is Sidney Carton. Sidney Carton is madly in love with the doctor's daughter and wants to marry her, but he realizes that his self-deprecating and self-destructive ways make him not an ideal candidate for any woman, much less the epitome of Victorian womanhood that Lucy is. So it is in this moment of catharsis that he promises Lucy that he would lay his life down for anybody dear to her when the occasion arises. Sidney Carton epitomizes mankind's ability to rise above itself, seek out the greater good, and even go to the extent of making the ultimate sacrifice for pure, undiluted love. Now, those who have watched The Dark Knight Rises would recall a scene wherein the Scarecrow is presiding over a kangaroo court trial, condemning a man named Stryver to exile for living off others' hard work and labor. Now, Stryver is also a character in A Tale of Two Cities. Stryver happens to be the senior colleague of lawyer Sidney Carton. Stryver is the person who does not allow Sidney Carton to explore his full abilities, his full potential. Stryver is the parasite that feeds off the labor of Sidney Carton to prosper while condemning Sidney Carton to a life of dependence, a life of debauchery, a debased life. It seems prophetic that 150 years after Charles Dickens created the character of Stryver, the Nolan brothers finally brought some semblance of justice to the proceedings by condemning striver to exile, for destroying Sidney Carton, for demoralizing Sidney Carton. In the same scene, you can see the character Bean, as played by actor Tom Hardy, knitting in the background even as the trial is going on. Ever wondered why he was knitting? The answer is very simple. This was a symbolic allusion to Madame Defarge, who was instrumental in leading Parisians to purge the city of all nobles. Madame Defarge was the sister of the girl that was raped and murdered by the noble family. She was the sister of the peasant boy that was killed by the noble family. For her, the revolution was an act of vengeance. And she had a very noble way of keeping count of victims and the people that were to be executed via a secret knitting pattern, which she would exchange with other people who were instrumental in leading the charge against nobility. The entire revolution sparked by Bane and Ra's al Ghul's daughter in Gotham City is merely a facet of the great revolution as documented by Charles Dickens in the pages of A Tale of Two Cities. When Batman volunteers to lay his life down for a city he so very much loves, it was reminiscent of Sidney Carton's ultimate sacrifice for the woman he loved, Lucy. When Chief Gordon delivers a prophetic speech regarding what future has in store for the city of Gotham, he was drawing heavily from the thoughts of Sidney Carton even as he was being taken for execution, holding the hands of a seamstress. Now, Dickens is known to have delivered many a social message through his writings, be it Oliver Twist, David Copperfield, Great Expectations. Such was the impact of his words that he was regarded in high esteem. He was treated like a rock star even before rock star had become a thing. But when an entire generation confines its energy, its attention to garnering, to gaining only second-hand experience, I am reminded of the prophetic speech delivered by writer Neil Gaiman. It was published in The Guardian in 2013. Neil Gaiman says, "Why our future depends on libraries, reading and daydreaming." He makes a case for fiction by saying, fiction has two uses. Firstly, it's a gateway drug to reading. The drive to know what happens next, to want to turn the page. The need to keep going, even if it's hard, because someone is in trouble and you have to know how it is all going to end. That's a very real drive. And it forces you to learn new words, to think new thoughts, to keep going. To discover that reading per se is pleasurable. Once you learn that, you are on the road to reading everything. And reading is key. There were noises made briefly a few years ago about the idea that we were living in a post-literate world in which the ability to make sense out of written words was somehow redundant. But those days are gone. Words are more important than they ever were. We navigate the world with our words, and as the world slips onto the web, we need to follow, to communicate and to comprehend what we are reading. People who cannot understand each other cannot exchange ideas, cannot communicate, and translation programs only go so far. Now, these are prophetic words, and it makes a very valid case for reading, going for the first-hand experience rather than the second-hand. But that does not mean cinematic adaptations are, by any stretch of imagination, a mean feat. But the problem is, it is the perception of the director. It's the director's take on the original content. And I would any day prefer the original work. While both these streams are avenues of entertainment, I believe that cinema is only a teaser to what a book hides in its bosom, and it will deliver all the goods to only those who go back to the bookshelf.